Hello and welcome everyone, this is Black at the RTS League channel. I welcome you to today's stream that is gonna be a bit earlier, already at 13 GMT. So that is when we're gonna be starting, and well, of course, that's gonna be meaning that a few Australians are actually gonna be involved. Team Australia B is gonna be starting their participation in Season 1 of Age of Empires 2 Rise of the Rajas Clan League hosted by RTS League. So we hope they're gonna be having a good time as they did last season. But yeah, well, the first round pitted them against Run Forest Run, last season bronze, so it's gonna be probably quite a bit of a challenge for them. Okay, we're already preparing for actually starting the game. So let's see how that's gonna go for us. And of course for the players as well. There we go. We're starting with the first game, where actually we are gonna be seeing some Kaui, so this is gonna be an expansion set map. And the map is gonna be what? Oh, it's gonna be Budapest, alright. That's interesting. Interesting indeed, it's gonna be the first in this season of RTS League. And it of course means we're gonna be having a lot of pawns across the map. As you can all the four, well, not really corners, rather sides of the map here. And that is of course gonna be interesting, for example, right now for the purple player, for Spaden, who is definitely gonna be the high skill player in this matchup, as otherwise we are gonna be also looking at, for example, green, Zayn Naik from Team Australia B, having also a bit of a water. Well, he definitely will have to be used to that as an Australian player, of course, unless he is somewhere in the middle, in the middle deserts of that continent. Of course, this is gonna be a 3v3, just to make sure that you realize what kind of level we are talking about here. Straya B are something about like 17 to 1750, they are actually not a bad team at all in here, as their A team is of course stronger, but B teams are not pushovers, no pushovers either. And for RFRs, as I said, they are basically bronze clan from the last season, and it basically means that they are about 1900 plus with their team play being really quite solid all around. So let's see how far they're gonna be coming this season, as the level is continually increasing and it's gonna be even heavier this time around. And well, we are apparently gonna be having a second scout here coming forward. Was that from the one player? I kind of think that it actually might have been. It actually might have really been, because yeah, of course, this is a map where you have having two scouts to basically start your game with, and that means that that was definitely two scouts, and unfortunately, one of them is already dead, as it seemed like that he might be actually attempting to steal something, but unfortunately for him, he didn't really succeed, and rather lost the scout there. Okay, so there are gonna be also a few boars right next to him, though they are kinda into the middle. You can see what's actually gonna be the combination of players and everything. It's gonna be DarklyWise, quite close to Zayn Naik. You can see they are really close, like within one screen, so this is gonna be actually quite interesting. And to be honest, this should be the home map of Run Forest Run. I haven't really noticed too much in the talk in the game room, but this should be RFR's actually home map. And it kinda would make sense, because they are the highest skill team, and that is usually... It is usually the team that picked Arabia before, but right now they are having plenty more extra options for themselves. Okay, so he's gonna be of course having some bit of a back-in by Spaden, so it's gonna be pretty hard double probably on Zayn Naik, but same could be said at the top side for Ganji, even though he's kind of far away of course from Jordan and BARI. So, kind of really interesting spawn, because all things considered, those guys are not as close, so potentially there could be a bit of a wall in between them. But looking, of course, as he's already established a bit more to the top as well. And see, of course, 2 TCs for all of them are gonna be a reality on Budapest also, because that's another thing. That is, of course, the staple for the Budapest map. We are gonna be really interested a whole lot more in this battlefield, as that will probably decide how the game is gonna go, especially in the early minutes of the feudal ages, and maybe even a bit further into the game. Yeah, you can see a bit of idle time already, unfortunately, for Jordan, as apparently he's having a bit of a run, yeah. With the scouts from Spaden. Now Spaden is gonna be the very first one to advance into the feudal age, and he is coming as the Chinese with double Huns on basically his flanks. It worked out rather well for them at 34 villages, so yeah, that's of course understandable, as the opponents are gonna be playing Chinese, Huns and Indians. So yeah, let's see what's gonna be better, because of course Huns, even though they are still very solid, they are not as strong as they used to be on AoC. And well, if you think that multiple civilizations are always an insta-win, absolutely not. Absolutely not. We have seen times and again that, for example, even in AoC, if you go with 3 Vikings, you can definitely lose. And yeah, that happened, for example, even to very high-skilled players like the Berserkers, aka Russian Vix. So, definitely not an insta-win, and you still need to basically play properly, and it has its risks. It has its risks. For example, that you are gonna be missing on some kind of team bonus from basically the third civilization. And much more importantly, you're gonna be a bit of a one-trick pony. As if you are having all the civilizations the same, the options are not really there. The diversity is really missing, and it can definitely be hurting you in the long run. Okay, so we are, as players are advancing into the next ages, into the feudal ages, all of them. Jordan is already rolling into the middle. You can see that he's basically making sure that he's not gonna be abused by anybody all that much. You can see that Zainaik is gonna be helping him in that effort, but he already did finish with pretty important walling right there. And looking at the gold, maybe that could be a bit of an issue for DarklyWise here, but probably not too much, because you can see that he already does have plenty of gold, at least to the top side, so a bit of walling, probably even using the gold, and he should be having a whole lot more somewhere, for example, here, like, okay, there is plenty to be actually spared, plenty to be even spared between him and Spaden, so yeah, they don't really have a problem relinquishing this gold, which in the end might even not be his. Oh well, probably it is, as there are plenty of resources on this map, so it probably doesn't matter a whole lot if you lose one mine. It's probably not gonna be having any kind of huge effect on anything too much. Alright, below walling on the right side by the Indian Bari, who already is of course prepared for anything that could be coming his way. And let's look, for example, who all is having the docks. So that's gonna be only grey. So far you can see that blue is not all that interested in the water. Kinda interestingly so, because once you have water, like, why not use it? As you can see that basically all three Australians are coming for extra fishing economy for them to help them in the boom. Right now looking at Jordan and gonna be looking also at Zainaik, who is also apparently not gonna be all that challenged by DarklyWise. And to be honest, looking how RFRs picked double Huns, that might really lead me to believe that they want to concentrate on some kind of land fighting. It's not really gonna be all that much of it yet, because the walling has been apparently done to quite a good degree for especially the team Australia. But otherwise, that's gonna be also resulting, of course, in something quite solid, as the early aggression is not really there, only a bit of a preparation for potential eventualities all around. And that is, of course, gonna be resulting in the Council Ages coming forward from right now four players: Spaden, DarklyWise, BARI, and Ganji. So basically, two Team Australias are still lagging behind, unfortunately, whereas RFRs, they are definitely heading forward. And already a challenge being dropped for one of the Huns on the left side. These are apparently gonna be cavalry archers. Cavalry archers for the red player, as for the right flank, so far we are seeing double stables, so it seems like that this Hun is gonna be concentrating on cavaliers into paladins a bit later. You can even see confirmation in the scale bar and armor being researched, and coinage is coming forward for BARI. He's advancing into the castle age, but going for a coinage, interesting, right there. Maybe he's gonna be wanting to send at least a few resources to his allies to prompt them up, as they're also getting into castle age, but basically at the latest time. And is there some kind of difference in the villages? Definitely is. Definitely is. So they basically opted to go for a more heavy boom on the economy faster before they advance into castle age. Let's see if it's gonna be the correct decision or not, as they are having about 5 to 9 villages more than their opponents, but otherwise the situation is really kinda equal, so not that much of a problem in that. What could be the problem, of course, is the army being here stronger and faster. So, of course, a bit of a walling from Zainaik is definitely gonna be needed. But is he gonna be in time? That's the big question. He's right now going for the gate here, so that he can protect at least his gold. You can see a lot of gate walling right next to the TC, so that he is as protected as humanly possible. And with, of course, the blacksmith coming on the left side as well, just basically part of the wall there, he should be in time, as the palisade wall is gonna be just now coming down. So this guy, unfortunately, probably gonna die, as he is on the wrong side of the wall there. But the rest, they should be probably finishing, and shouldn't be all that much of a problem. Yeah, well, there you go. He's gonna be dead, deader than dead, as those are probably not gonna be having enough range to go there. But problem is not here yet. I was just maybe looking if potentially this could be an issue, if, of course, there was a hole into the wall and into the bases of, for example, right now Jordan, and of course Ganji or other BARI on the right side. But it's not really the case, as we see that. How did they get through? I don't exactly see how actually they got through, but anyway, they did already. They already did. You can see there wasn't enough cut there, because there was a house, so I'm not really sure how they got through, but anyway, they did manage that. They even deleted the extra house that was built there, and that is, of course, right now a pretty big problem, It's a big problem for BARI, as he will have to defend quite significantly, and if he doesn't really do it properly, you can see there is right now a huge hole, as apparently that's already gonna be walled up, so BARI is paying enough attention. Oh well. Right now changing his mind Ganji in that, so that's gonna be given all the time in the world for, of course, one of the players here to finish with the wall in. As well, the Knights are also coming forward in numbers from Jordan, so it seems like that this is not really gonna be all that effective in the end, and they're gonna have to wait for, so for example, Imperial Age, which is, in the end, gonna be coming as the very first one from Zai Knight, with Bloodlines and Chainbinding Armor. And that's the Hunt player, so of course, these are gonna be horses coming from him, so you should be expecting plenty more stables, and then since he does have quite a solid economy on the water, and he is also scouting with the Fire Galley just to make sure his opponent is not gonna be having any kind of ideas. He should be having actually pretty good game on his hands with the horses, but also there is Red, who he has been able to get through, and what? Oh well, here, okay. So unfortunately, Jordan was just not really fast enough. He lost 3 villages, maybe 4, yeah 4. There is also skeleton behind the stone line in there. 4 villages on trying to build the wall, and he still failed. There's a 5th carcass right here standing, and that of course is a pretty horrible disaster, as that's gonna be meaning that Jordan will have to probably defend both himself and also his ally, not only on the right, but maybe also on the left side, as right now DarklyWise is gonna be giving him a bit of a respite. Interesting decision right there, and maybe gonna be a bit more concentrating on of course his opponent, as he is definitely aiming to break through as soon as possible, though looking at all of those buildings, that's gonna be pretty hard just by arrows. But once it actually happens, this food economy is definitely gonna be in full threat. But yeah, we can see that he's already gonna be having prepared probably some Mangonel. Mangonel is just not gonna be built, even with some ram to soak up a bit of a damage. Well, let's see how many shots he can be actually getting on the opponent here. Alright, that was not a bad one at all. And it's of course gonna be forcing them to retreat, because they don't have the same range and they will be just completely slaughtered. Not really fast and quickly, but in the end it would of course be working quite alright for the green player. Alright, you can see that Spaden is gonna be castle dropping basically on his opponents in the middle, and we are gonna be expecting that he's gonna be really finishing up without all that much of a problem, and apparently a bit of a slink is still is rather going on by from BARI, and BARI was the one who was actually going for the coinage, right? I think that he was. I really think that he was, as we're also looking still at the Radiant, and finally even some Siege. Mangonel coming forward into BARI's base, and that might be resulting into not such a nice situation, as of course you can see that those guys might be really dying to all of those shots. Yeah, exactly. Exactly, that's the problem with the Mangonels, and of course the TCs as well, and he's losing tons of economy at this point. It's like at least 10 farms that are not working for him at all. That is something that is basically quite deadly for him, considering that he's slinging a bit to his allies. As Cavalier is coming for Zainaik, very rare for the opponents. They are having just Spaden in the Imperial Age, but he's also the one with the best boom at this point, well, almost the best boom, at 106, as all three RFRs are 100+, whereas Straya's are 84, 78 and 68, so their economies are definitely kind of lagging behind their opponents, and you can kind of guess what that's going to mean. Though, it doesn't have to mean a game loss, as you can see that Zainaik is definitely not interested in any kind of early design, as he is already pushing on his opponent, and with Cavaliers against Cavalry Archers, that's a very good proposition. That's a very good proposition indeed, and we're just gonna be waiting what's gonna happen now. Maybe the best idea would be for Spaden to supply some halberdiers, but there is also the unit that actually the Hunt can produce himself, though he will have to prepare for that. You can see he's already dropping the barracks in there, so it's gonna be up to him to defend with all the helps against all the onslaught of the horses, and he's having quite a lot of villages idle right now. He has already lost about 10+. You can see he has dropped below the 100 in there, and having 37, right now 39 villages idle. It's like half of his economy almost, and that is definitely opening quite a bit of opportunity for Zainaik to definitely punish him for being all that cheeky, trying to beat him with only cavalry archers. But yeah, well, that doesn't seem to be like the good and the best idea. As here though, Spaden in the middle, basically undisrupted altogether. His boom is gonna be really problematic for the opponents to deal with, as three castles right on your doorstep, with probably rocketry coming forward quite soon for the Chukonus as well. That is gonna be one hell of a challenge. As on the other side of the map, we are looking at a few monks from the Indians being ready to steal a few horses from Ganji. And with the help from Jordan, with all the horses, It seems to be working rather well, as Blue was forced into the defensive in there and he's gonna be waiting for his Imperial Age so that he can also get a few more extra upgrades up there. In the meantime, Green is gonna be basically ravaging the countryside all across the map for the opponents who run for a strand, as a whole lot of stables are being made by Spaden and it's gonna be basically switching into camels. Most definitely against all the horses as well, so halberdiers coming from pretty soon, well, once he gets into the Imperial Age of course, pretty soon from DarklyWise, and this is actually gonna be good opportunity. Good opportunity for Zainai, as if he can get the paladins exactly right now clicking them in, if he can get them fast enough, which really seems like that it could be the case, it could be really quite a big problem for Run Forestra. I'm not sure how they're gonna be dealing with that, because we mustn't forget that DarklyWise is still in the Castle Age. And you can see he's absolutely not advancing anywhere, anytime close. So he cannot get the halberdiers, and of course just pikemen are not really gonna be kinda enough against paladins. It's just not really gonna be good. So really not sure how they're gonna be dealing with that. I fully expect that Spaden will have to spend a lot of his resources, not only those Chukonus, but also those camels that he's already gonna be preparing onto the defense of his team and of his teammates overall. Well, otherwise he's in the middle quite deadly. So maybe it's gonna be also forcing Zainai a whole lot more into the defensive. You can see another castle being dropped. He's really taking all the resources and much more importantly, the map control in the middle of the map. Definitely doing it properly and with a few trebuchets, he's still gonna be able to basically level all the bases. And right now Zainai is gonna be having his economy quite threatened. Quite threatened indeed by basically destroying all the town centers and maybe even just the farms themselves. Because kinda, at this point, why not? A trebuchet could be just put on automatic fire. Alright, already coming forward with a few more stables so that he doesn't have to walk and run all that far away, or rather far away. With all of the units into the enemy territory. With Jordan also looking into the Imperial Age. And that is gonna be, of course, the Chinese player. And what is his idea gonna be? Looking at the amount of horses, it's probably gonna be just some cavaliers to basically get him going. But otherwise, we would be really expecting that he's gonna be switching into castles. And of course, with that, into a few others. Like the Chukonus with them. But does he have the stone? Kinda does. Though he's also housed, as he's already going for the extra houses. So it shouldn't be all that much of a problem for too long. Let's look, for example, at like the population limit. It's kinda interesting stat. You can see that Ganji is at 166. And where is the army, actually? Having just this squad of horses, I don't see anything all that extra. So he's probably having a really solid economy. Well, 136, so of course, explains quite a bit. Really explains quite a bit as he's coming for the cavaliers. That's gonna be Paladin quite soon after, I would be expecting. Just gonna be checking what's going on in the game room. They seem to be still in, so it shouldn't be really anything bad. And they should be having just a standard pause. So of course, in the meantime, just finish with what you're talking about. And that's the population limit. As the only one in trouble is DarklyWise, and that's understandable, looking at what is going on inside his base, as he's right now transitioning to the pikeman. But much more importantly, he has lost a lot of economy. Not only because he right now cannot really gather too much, he has lost plenty of farms, but he has lost about 40 villages, 30 to 40 villages, in the last about 5 minutes, so that's actually a pretty huge blow to him. And that is of course one of the reasons why he just doesn't have enough resources how to get into the Imperial Age in time. Well, for Strayas, they are at 101, 130, and Jordan is 156 and housed. Some achievements for this part of the game. So what did they actually do there? Not much, just Zainai having quite a huge score, but he is slung, so it's not much of a surprise, to be honest. Spaden is playing though on his own, so you can see he's not having all that much of a difference in the score, and he's still quite fine. And Irish Mikos, well, to be honest, not really anybody. Because Zainai was having significant advantage against DarklyWise on the left and he was raiding really well. But at the same time, Spaden was absolutely undisturbed, or absolutely pretty much. And he was already spreading kinda like plague in the middle. So, quite honestly, seeing how Spaden is by far the best player in the game, he probably would have a pretty good chance to carry on. So, if I were to favor anybody, it would be RFRs, even through the problems for DarklyWise on the left side. But yeah, it's kinda hard to tell. Zainai with the paladins coming forward, it definitely still could be quite a threat for RFRs. Maybe he could make it work. We'll see. Really, the game is open. Definitely not decided yet fully. You can see the sling going on. Nothing really all that major. 6,500 into BARI, or rather the other way around, from BARI to Zainaik and a bit to Jordan. So yeah, let's quit this game and wait for the rest of them. There we go, we're gonna be continuing with the game. It's pretty great that we do have the restore. So we continue right now going on, and this is exactly right now the plague that I was talking about, and it's getting much worse and it's spreading. It's right now pretty much a bubonic plague already in Jordan's base, as even though he does have castles prepared, it seems like he's gonna be finishing with the second one just in time. All those horses, paladins in there with fully upgraded, Zainaik is fully upgraded at this point, but those, I think he's gonna be coming for cavaliers, as he is, because of course why not? It's a quite a solid upgrade, but with all of those horses coming forward and being professionally blocked by by Spaden, it's really funny, he cannot get through. He would so want to get through with his cavaliers in deck. I mean, even for coinage Ganji, he is gonna be allowed just now. Come on. Yeah, Spaden is just not gonna let him. Just not gonna let him at all. He's right now gonna even try to finish with the stone wall. He is coming forward and... Is he like completely blocking him? Yeah, he's trolling. He has to be trolling. He absolutely has to be trolling, because right now there's no way around the trebuchet. He's actually into the base. This is too funny. Or is there? Oh, there is! There is, but not anymore. So yeah, I'm pretty sure he's trolling. Yeah, Spaden is right now trolling, not allowing Ganji to actually go into attack. But he should be really careful, because he might be really costing him quite a bit if he's not careful. Because right now you can see Jordan is professionally also going all around the Chukonos. Right now they are in a bit of a choke point, but nothing really all that major, as the paladins are finally let loose. They're gonna be, of course, fighting against the green paladins. The blue ones, though, are not fully upgraded, so they're gonna get slaughtered. You can see they're having only plus 2 attack, whereas the green ones are having already plus 4. So, yeah, all fun and games. But right now, it could be actually screwing over them quite significantly. The caster is down through the trebuchets. And, well, of course, on the left side, this is gonna be a bit of an extra breather for DarklyWise, as he doesn't have to face all the paladins from the opponent. But, of course, the huge battle in the middle is so far, just due to sheer numbers, and of course, the Chukonus, already with rocketry. You can see all the extra attack that they're having. They're really pushing through, and they seem to be really winning at this point anyway in this large battle, as on the right side there is a bit of an attempt for maybe BARI to push through, as we are waiting for the players, and fingers crossed, it's not gonna be any drop. And yeah, well, there we go. Villager dead. Not any more siege workshops coming forward. But of course, much more important battle is still happening in the middle, where a few more Chukonus are coming forward yet again, and with the paladin still being very much alive. Yeah, that is a pretty deadly combination, with another castle being attempted and quite probably also gonna be getting finished reasonably soon here. As even though Imperial Age for BARI and for DarklyWise is coming forward, I'm kind of thinking that it might not be really all that important here, as this battle with right now Forgeon being in there, or the Blast Furnace being in there already, for the Blue Horses as well, it's gonna be everybody at the same line of upgrades, and that is of course not gonna be anything that Jordan would be able to withstand, because he's not ready for the production of the Chukonus yet. He doesn't have all the upgrades so far, and he's not even having elites in there, so he's of course gonna get pretty much slaughtered. And well, those blue horses are doing their job, destroying all the villagers and pillaging as much as they can, and of course in the meantime abusing a few women here and there. Okay, so the castle is still standing. Doesn't seem like the trebuchets would be anywhere close by right about now, as the economy is pretty much ready for the teal player. He's right now, even though he's having 130 villages, 20 are idle, and much more importantly, he has lost about like million farms at this point. You cannot even count that somehow reasonably. So yeah, well, without the economy, how can he actually support all the army that he wants to produce, especially with DarklyWise right now pouring in like a tidal wave, of course, with another castle being dropped for the Huns. So that's gonna be more for like some kind of upgrades that he has just now clicking in, and maybe even a few trebuchets, but also a few targans wouldn't be such a bad idea, as they would be quite solid against any kind of buildings, quite of course. So yeah, there we go, the GGs are going to be called. So after all, after the restore, it didn't really take all that long, as of course it ended kinda as we expected, that Spaden undisturbed. That's usually not a good idea, and it happened exactly as we expected, as unfortunately Zainaik wasn't able to finish with DarklyWise in time, even though in 1v1 he most probably would have won, or most probably he definitely would have won. That wasn't really any kind of really doubt about that, he was really winning in there. But luckily for DarklyWise, there was still Spaden and of course his teammate Ganji as well, and that's why we are playing team games, because Yep, we are looking for team performance. So it doesn't really rely on one single player. So well done, let's look at the achievements now at the end of the game. It's of course gonna be Spaden with the highest score, and that is of course quite well performed because he wasn't slung and he was just playing as you would be expecting him to, as the best player in the game. You can see not really any kind of sling whatsoever, just a few resources to help him. And even without that, even without the sling, as the sling was coming, for example, into Zainai, he just wasn't to be destroyed. But Zainai played really well with the sling. Wasn't really hard bad. GG.